We've seen more than 900 patients in this facility. We know that COVID is a devastating disease. We've definitely had losses. Some have been more painful than others. More in the last waves, it's been harder because our patients have been a lot younger. It's been that unvaccinated population that didn't have access to the vaccine in the first round. We've had some very dear colleagues who have passed away. And I mean, that is something that literally shattered all of us.
Fellow Kenyans, I want to inform you that the Ministry of Health has confirmed the first coronavirus case in Kenya.
Much like the rest of the world, initially we were just getting information off the news, looking at this new virus that was coming out of Asia, specifically China. But we did have the blessing of time, because by the time this was actually hitting our borders, we had some guidelines from the doctors in Wuhan. We also had guidelines from CDC, and now we had to set about changing our protocols within the hospital. One, we had to look at identifying a space for where were we going to manage these patients. What was the kind of equipment we were going to need to protect ourselves and to protect the patients? We had to set about training our staff, identifying the kind of staff who'd be willing to work in those areas, and also training our staff how to look after themselves outside of the hospital, because COVID wasn't in the hospital at that point. COVID was in the community. We were one of the first hospitals to set up a separate triage center in our accident and emergency, so we could already filter patients who at that time had any flu-like symptoms or any history of travel. Every patient represents a family. I mean, for every patient you see, there's, you know, their parents, their children, their siblings. It's been, I think the toughest thing with COVID is the fact that when you manage these patients, most of the time in isolation, they never get to see your face. So we actually developed a WhatsApp call system so that even if you are outside the unit, you could call the patients on their phone and do a video call so that this patient didn't always feel you're just a pair of eyes behind goggles. We've done great work when it comes to COVID. A lot of campaigns on COVID, on social media. We've done a lot of interviews, like trying to educate people on how is it spread, how can you protect yourself. And you see, that has even now rolled into our vaccination campaign. We are one of the centers that's doing the vaccination rollout, which is a very strong campaign. And we know you can't always, right now we still don't have a cure for COVID. We only have treatment modalities that work in certain individuals at certain times. They're quite expensive. So the free vaccination rollout is one of the biggest things that we're also doing currently. We also at that time had to look at how do we provide services for our patients. You had to look at the patients who had COVID and the patients who don't have COVID. Of course, when this happened last year, the first thing was fear. No one wanted to come to the hospital, which means if you're diabetic, if you're hypertensive, how do we make sure that the hospital is safe for you? So we had to designate zones. So if you needed to come in for your normal and routine follow-up, you were still safe to come into the hospital. We developed a telemedicine system, meaning you could actually book your appointment and have your session with the doctor online, whether it was via WhatsApp or Zoom, so that you could still see your doctor and we could provide that service. We developed pharmacy and lab on wheels. So if you needed to get your tests done, we could have someone sent over and get your labs. If you needed to get your medications, we could still make sure that you got your medication. So we still had to have a continuity of care for people without COVID. For COVID infection, we also had to develop a home-based care, meaning you had a COVID-19 infection, but you didn't need to be in the hospital. So we needed to make sure that you had the equipment to monitor yourself at home, you had whatever supportive medication, and you had a doctor that you could reach out to that if you weren't doing well, you would be able to come into the hospital and we could continue following you up from there. We have our own oxygen plant that was also launched this year. So at least now in terms of that, we know that, you know, God forbid, if we do end up in another wave, we know that we have that safety net for our patients. I've learned that sometimes your best can still not be good enough, because at the end of the day, what you want is a patient to go home. And sometimes you're battling against something that is even beyond science. But I think the biggest thing is to have your set of people, to be willing to learn more and understand that, especially with something like this, the evidence is always changing. So maybe something you held true 2-3 months ago might be different now. And it doesn't mean you were wrong or it was a mistake. It's that you have to learn and evolve with the work that you're doing.